Last June, I was quite fortunate to travel to Brussels on an IES-PIE Community College faculty fellowship, and I'm grateful to IES, the Benelux Program, the European Union Center, and the U.S. Department of Education for their Title VI funds that gave me the opportunity to study the EU, its institutions, and particularly its semi-official home, Brussels. One of the conditions of the fellowship was to report on how that visit informs my own pedagogy, and that is part of the reason why I'm here today. The study tour focused on the institutions of the EU, which helps a historian like myself in a number of ways. Most obviously, when teaching Western civilization, the reasons behind the creation of the European Union are very important. And how that body actually works is complex, so my ability to explain it to students is stronger for my trip, that's for sure. But the lessons of the study tour are not limited to courses that touch on European history. This concerns American history too. How does an international body create itself? The original confederation of 13 colonies did not work out. Can we draw analogies between that and the evolution of the EU? How do we create an institutional balance between centralized power and individuals' rights? The EU is asking those questions just as the American framers did in 1787 when writing the Constitution. How do you leave such an institution? Hopefully Brexit will not have the same result that secession did in 1860 and 1861. At least the EU has an article that covers such an eventuality. Well, while all those things have proven quite valuable to me pedagogically, the thing that I found most interesting and perhaps most timely was the story that Belgium tells us about nationalism. Nationalism is most interesting where it is most contested, and Belgium is certainly just such a place. So what I would like to do is briefly recapitulate the development of nationalism in Belgium, how it became so closely tied with language, how Belgium has tried to resolve those conflicts over nationalism, and what this might portend for Belgium and the world. We start in 2007, actually. A funny thing happened one day to the incoming Belgian Prime Minister, Yves Leterme. It was not just any day, it was July 21st, the Belgian national holiday, and Leterme was on his way to the Cathedrale de Saints Michel et Gudule in Brussels for the traditional Te Deum and services there. Mm-hmm. On his way in, a reporter from the French language news television station, RTBF, asked the Prime Minister, what was it all about? And let's see if we can watch this real quickly here.
Tédéum bruxellois auquel assistait aussi Yves Leterme, le formateur, probable futur Premier ministre. L'occasion de lui poser quelques questions sur la Belgique et son histoire. Les réponses sont assez déconcertantes.
Disconcerting answer from the Prime Minister.
Le Tédéum lance traditionnellement la fête nationale. Selon un sondage, un Belge sur cinq sait pourquoi cette fête a lieu le 21 juillet. Parmi les ignorants, le probable futur Premier ministre de Belgique.
Il paraît que les Belges ne connaissent pas bien la Belgique. Est-ce que vous savez pourquoi on fête le 21 juillet le 21 juillet?
He's asking, what is the national holiday?
Je crois la proclamation de la Constitution.
I think it's the proclamation of the Constitution.
C'est autre chose, c'est un rapport avec le pont premier. Pardon? C'est un rapport avec le
pont premier. Coronation of the first king.
Ça va être la désignation de l'épaule premier.
Prestation entièrement.
Prestation entièrement, voilà.
Le Brabançon, vous la connaissez?
Do you know the national anthem, the Brabançon?
Allez-y.
Can you sing it? So, instead of the Belgian national anthem, he began singing the French national anthem. So, what's going on here? At a certain level, not that much. A French language TV station is punking a politician, but that same news organization actually did a poll and discovered that only one in five Belgians could actually state the correct reason for the national holiday, and probably very few Belgians can sing all three versions of the national anthem. So, Leterme is kind of in good company. What was striking about this was the incoming prime minister of the country did not know the first thing about the country's national symbols. This might not reflect ignorance or stupidity on the part of the prime minister, but rather the lack of nationalism in Belgium. Scratch the surface of Belgium just a little bit, however, and what you find is that there are indeed very many nationalistic Belgians. It's just that they're not nationalistic about Belgium. This hasn't always been that way. How did Belgium come to be at once extremely nationalistic and almost devoid of nationalism? To understand that, you have to look at the origins of Belgium, the development of linguistic nationalism, how the Belgian state has tried to accommodate the linguistic nationalism, and how Belgium now fits in with the larger European community. Just some basic facts about Belgium. that's the reason why they celebrate July 21st, crowning of Leopold I in 1831. Belgium has two main languages, Dutch, French. There's a mixed area in Belgium where the action's at. And then finally, there's a tiny little bit of Belgium that speaks German. Jeroen knows all about this. It's about 60% Dutch-speaking, about 40% French-speaking, and the total number of German-speaking people, well, it's about half the population of Berkeley, actually. I find it really ironic that the official motto of the country is unity makes strength, because they absolutely lack it. It is a constitutional monarchy. Their king, Philippe, is king of the Belgians, not Belgian king, and he's relatively new. His father abdicated in 2013. They adopted pure primogeniture in 1991, and thus Princess Elizabeth is the heir apparent, despite the fact that she has brothers. Belgium will have a queen regnant someday, we think. Well, Belgium is old and it's new. The earliest use of the word is Belgi by Julius Caesar. He considered them to be the bravest of all the peoples of Gaul, though it's a little unclear if he thought that they were part of Gaul or distinct from the Gauls. But it's nice to be mentioned anyway. The language line has largely been fixed since the early Middle Ages, with Germanic languages spoken in the north, Romance languages in the south, and it's only the area around Brussels that has really changed in terms of its linguistic profile. The nation does not exist outside the imagination of its members. The country might exist as a physical place, and it is delimited by boundaries set by a state, but the we of we the people is something that is created, and it is constantly changing over time, even though it often pretends to be something that is essential and immutable. In the case of Belgium, it had a name long before it even really had a fully geographic expression. Belgium was simply described as part of the Low Countries. It's certainly what we call Netherlands, Belgium, maybe Luxembourg, parts of northern France. They were close to the North Sea, they grew fairly wealthy through commerce, and they were densely populated. The territories changed hands several times, from Burgundy to Spanish Habsburg to Austrian Habsburg, with the strongly Protestant Dutch dropping out of the mostly Catholic Low Countries club along the way. It tended to be torn between the ambitions of France and the ambitions of the Habsburgs. Belgium itself was taken over by France during the Revolutionary Wars, but then it was taken over by the United Netherlands in 1815 as a result of the Congress of Vienna. There was a certain amount of resentment over this because while the House of Orange was elevated to the status of kings, the Dutch-speaking king was Protestant and the French-speaking Belgian elites were Catholic. Belgium has the distinction of being perhaps the only revolution that started with an opera in 1830, but there is background, of course. From 1827 onwards, there's a coalition of liberals and Catholics united in opposition to the Protestant Dutch king. Liberal ideas were at the center of this revolution and enshrined in the program of freedom for in everything for everyone. And after a brief war with the Netherlands, Belgium was independent and united. This, by the way, the triggering aria is not the national anthem, although you would think that would make sense. The opera was La Muette du Portici by Aubert. So, Belgium became an independent and united state, and partly because of sympathy for the Belgians by the British. They did not want a French king, and so they were happy with Leopold I of Saxe-Coburg-Gotha becoming crowned. There's a close connection with the English monarchy here. He was not only the father of, he's the uncle of Queen Victoria, as well as the father-in-law of Queen Victoria. She married her first cousin. That's how that works out. The great powers agreed in 1839. Belgium was to be neutral, not connected to France or connected to the Netherlands. Belgium became independent and united just at the time that it was becoming two very different regions economically. The southern Francophone part of the country industrialized and became prosperous. The northern Dutch-speaking part remained rural and not as wealthy. As different economic developments began to separate Flemings and Walloons, that is, and I'm using these slightly loosely, the Walloons I'm using as a synonym for Francophone. That's not entirely true, but it will have to do for right now. Flemings are the Dutch-speaking Belgians. Other differences, as these economic developments happened, other differences began to show themselves as well. This liberal Catholic alliance of the Revolution did not last in the absence of a Protestant Dutch ruler, and one of the distinguishing markers between Flemings and Walloons became their relative piety, with Flemings retaining their Catholic piety while the Walloons tended to become much more anti-clerical, and this became even more pronounced with the emergence of the Belgian Socialist Party, which tended to be the strongest in the industrial area of the country, which is in Wallonia. Brussels is different. It's bilingual and it's different. The Second Industrial Revolution, of course, occurred in Belgium, and textiles, iron, steel, coal. The North remained relatively backward and rural throughout the 19th century. That switches after World War II, and it's crucial in understanding the linguistic politics of it. The constitution of the Belgian state originally was based on the French constitution. It's a highly restrictive franchise. You had to own so much property and pay so much taxes in order to get the vote. And politics was dominated by a French-speaking bourgeoisie. It wasn't necessarily the case that these were Walloons, however. It was a French-speaking bourgeoisie, but the language of education in the state was French. So Flemings, who were educated and politically enfranchised, which was a minority given this property-based franchise, spoke French as well as Dutch. At first, this was more of a class division than a national one. French was the official language, and Dutch was seen as somewhere between dialect and lower class indicator. Hence the expression, French in the parlor, Dutch in the kitchen. But that threatened to leave the Belgians with nothing to distinguish themselves from the French, and thus Belgian identity did depend on a certain Flemishness, even if it was expressed in French. And this was reflected in Charles de Coster's attempt to create a Belgian national literature out of Til Eulenspiegel, who's a Flemish trickster hero. It was written, however, in French. At least in terms of fiction, some forms of compromise were possible. It's in historical memory that the split between Walloons and Flemings really began. Fairly soon after the unification of Belgium in 1830, a new narrative of the past began to take shape. No longer one of multiple provinces being handed back and forth between great powers, depending on the vagaries of war and dynastic politics, the past began to take on the narrative of a particular people. And that narrative came to separate Belgians as well as to unite. One of the best examples of this is the Battle of Courtrai, or as it is known in Flanders, the Battle of the Golden Spurs in 1302. Plucky Flemish soldiers destroyed the cream of the French cavalry and marked the beginning of Flemish nationalism. It acts a little like Flemish Agincourt, okay? Or did it? While the battle did occur and the Flemish infantry did indeed win the battle, they went on to lose the war. And the battle itself was largely forgotten until the 18th century. Moreover, the language that those infantry spoke would have been incomprehensible to 19th century Flemish nationalists. But that did not stop the cult of the Huldenspanschlacht from spreading in the 19th century, epitomized in Hendrik Conscience's book, The Lion of Flanders. That's the 19th century version of the Battle of the Golden Spurs. And Hendrik Conscience, who wrote a book, The Lion of Flanders, in 1838. Sure enough, a monument to the battle and a couple of local heroes was erected later in the 19th century in Bruges, partly to commemorate the battle, and partly to drum up tourist attraction. It seems to have accomplished that. The date of the battle was then adopted in the 1970s as the day of the Flemish community in Belgium. Conscience went on, in fact, to anonymously co-author a pamphlet, Declaration of the Fundamental Principles of the Flemish Movement in 1847. Well, the Walloon community tended to snicker at the commemoration of a Flemish victory from so long ago, but by 1912 it was responding in kind with their own national symbols and a Walloon national holiday, September 27th, which was the date of the establishment of a provisional government during the Belgian Revolution of 1830. Some Walloon nationalists began to go even further in their demands for a separate identity in Belgium, which ultimately led to a famous letter written in 1912 to the Belgian king by Jules d'Estrées, who's a lawyer and a socialist politician. While he did not believe in dissolving Belgium, it wasn't even 100 years old at that point, he did think that a new federal state was needed because, after all, il n'y a pas de Belge, there are no Belgians. The king read the letter and privately admitted that d'Estrées had a point, but publicly said nothing, as he might have lost his job. After all, he was king of the Belgians. And thus, Belgian identity was already a contentious subject before the First World War. Part of the reason for this is a relative loss of status for French language and culture before the First World War. First of all, suffrage reform empowered a lot more Dutch-speaking Belgians in 1893, and by 1898, the constitution itself became officially bilingual. In 1913, Dutch was approved for use in Flemish schools, courts, and local government, and in 1932, Dutch was required in Flemish schools. Part of the reason for this is the loss of the Franco-Prussian War by the French in 1870. Suddenly, German had relatively greater appeal in the late 19th century. German universities were the best in the world. German science was world-renowned. The German army had certainly shown its stuff in 1870 and 1871. And among Flemish, the sort of romanticist slash German conception of what constituted a nation began to take hold. Well, the Great War did not heal the divisions in Belgian society. Belgium was mostly occupied, except for this little tiny salient here. For the most part, Belgium was occupied rather quickly in the First World War. And it's in the memory of the Great War was an important marker in the development of Flemish nationalism. The German invasion, of course, was used in British and American propaganda, and the rape of Belgium was one of the centerpieces of world perception of what Belgium was all about. Let's see. The memory of the Great War was an important marker in this nationalistic development and the waning of Belgian nationalism. Despite the fact that Belgium, you know, plucky little Belgium, was ostensibly the casus belli for the British entering the war, the Belgians themselves retained a memory of the war that was significantly different from other nations. Most of the country was occupied quite quickly, and thus much of the memory was not of brave young men going over the top, whether in a heroic or tragic mode, but of poor rations and moral compromises. Walloon memory of the Great War tended to focus on what was perceived as the favored status of Flemish under the German occupation. The Governor General of Belgium, General Moritz von Bissing, created a separate administrative units out of Flanders and Wallonia, and even fulfilled a long-standing Flemish demand for a Dutch-speaking university during the war. What memory does remain of the trench experience is also sometimes colored by the Belgian linguistic divide. French was the only language of command in the Belgian army, despite the fact that a majority of soldiers spoke Dutch. Max Deville's novel, The Mud of Flanders, uses the linguistic duality of the Belgian army to stress the irony of the war, with a French officer addressing the largely Flemish soldiers of the Battle of Yser in high-flung French prose, only to have the Flemish soldiers mutter in reply, "Was echt der? Tis nix, das allemal klutrei." What's he saying? It's nothing. It's all bullshit. A front bewegung, or front movement formed in the army during the war to call for Dutch rights in the armed forces. But that was squashed by the army. The memory of a distinctively Flemish nature of the sacrifice of the Great War continued after that war. And just a year after the peace treaty was signed at Versailles, a pilgrimage tradition was started, with Flemings going to Dixmude to remember not Belgian sacrifices, but Flemish sacrifices. Within 10 years, the pilgrimage tradition had acquired a large stone monument with the initials AVV, VVK, Alles voor Flandern, Flandern voor Christus, all for Flanders, Flanders for Christ. This, by the way, was dynamited after World War I and later restored after World War II, and it was later restored. Belgium did come out of the Paris Peace Conference bigger, but not by much. They acquired some of Germany's East African colonies, what would later be called Rwanda and Burundi, and they picked up a few small German-speaking towns on the border with Germany. They tried to sell them back to Germany, but that deal fell apart in 1926. This was the beginning of the German-speaking community in Belgium. Well, if the Great War was crucial in helping to foster the linguistic and social division of Belgian society, the interwar period and World War II were perhaps even more influential, but also much more bitter and unhappy. You see the rise of both Flemish and Walloon communities with small minorities that set themselves up as quasi-fascist political parties. There's a Communist Party, too, which made domestic politics very contentious. Foreign policy moved to neutrality, which in turn was guaranteed by Nazi Germany in 1937. I think we all know what that was worth. The Germans invaded again, and Belgium was occupied again, but this time they had to get in line, the Belgians had to get in line with a lot of other countries to be a special victim of German aggression. What was different this time was the presence of these several new organizations that had ideological agendas and not just naked self-interest and collaborationism. Both the Flemish and the Walloons created SS units, and ironically, each wound up fighting alongside each other on the Eastern Front at the very end of the war. Some 25,000 Jews were deported from Belgium to Auschwitz. This continued after the war, and one of the things that really helped to fracture Belgian identity was the royal question after the war. The king, Leopold III, stayed in Belgium during the occupation, unlike the Dutch queen, who ran away to England. And when the war was over, it became a very big question, do we want him back? This dragged on until 1950, when there was a national referendum, which distinctly split along linguistic lines. It was a narrow majority for his return, but it was almost more than three quarters of the Flemings who wanted him to come back. The Walloons were much more reluctant to see him return. The result was that he abdicated in favor of his son, Baudouin, and so he never returned. The post-war memory of the war also fractured along linguistic lines. The upper officer class was still largely Francophone, and some Flemish POWs actually were able to return to Belgium during the war. Walloons were not, and thus there was a certain sense, particularly among the Walloons, that the Flemings had been treated better than the French-speaking Belgians, and that this might in fact reveal something about their ultimate loyalty. The purge that happened in Belgium after the war tended to hit the Flemings harder as a result, and there were hundreds executed, many without trials, for collaborationism. Maybe as much as a quarter of the German-speaking Belgian community was accused of collaborationism. And thus, Flemish separatism immediately after the Second World War tended to be tainted with collaborationism. And as I said before, this huge tower at Dixmude was actually blown up secretly by people who have never been found. It's never been revealed exactly who did that. Well, Belgium did recover from the trauma of World War II and began to prosper even. But that prosperity was not evenly divided, and that division had political and linguistic repercussions. The economic changes really hit Belgium very hard, and deindustrialization hit industrial Belgium. Well, industrial Belgium was Wallonia, the French-speaking portion of the country, while Flanders began to boom, and particularly the port of Antwerp became a very important economic engine for the north of the country. Well, what this meant was that a territorial solution was sought for political and economic problems that had been engendered by this intricate and unequal development. The Flemings wanted political power to match their new economic power. The Walloons wanted political power to counter their economic decline. The post-war period also saw the completion of the pillarization of Belgian society. Before World War I, there had been separate Catholic, socialist, and liberal political parties, trade unions, various other organizations. After World War II, those in turn were split along linguistic lines. Now, instead of three pillars of Belgian society, you had six, and none of them spoke to each other. It took several years, however, for Belgian nationalism to recover from World War II, but recover it did, and through, I'm sorry, not Belgian nationalism, Flemish nationalism, but recover it did, and through long and repeated negotiations, the constitution of Belgium was reworked multiple times, which, with each change, providing for a little more autonomy and a lot more bureaucracy. Flemings and Walloons have, in a way, conflicting ways of imagining community borders. The Flemings want defined historic boundaries to prevent Francization. Essentially French-speaking people moving into and beginning to dominate traditionally Flemish territories. The Walloons, of course, want a census. If we're a majority in this particular administrative district, why not call it a French-speaking district? Well, that there is no compromise from that. The deal that was worked out in 1963 at the Val Duchesse conference created essentially a fixed language border situation with some exceptions to this territorial definition. It ends the practice of asking language questions in the census, and it establishes language facilities in specific municipalities. What does that mean? Well, where there's a significant minority of one language group resides, they will be able to communicate with government officials in their language, even if the residence is officially within the other language community. And this is where the really bitter battles are fought, is in these areas with language facilities. And it's especially important in the six municipalities around Belgium. Brussels, Halle, Vilvoorde is where the action's at when it comes to all these really bitter, bitter battles. This results in a very complicated Belgian state. There have been seven constitutional changes in less than 30 years. I have to shrink it down to 8-point type in order to fit it all in here. And thus there is a national government. Then there are three regions, Flanders, Wallonia, and the Brussels capital region. Brussels is officially bilingual, and each of these has its own elected parliament. There are also three communities, Dutch-speaking, French-speaking, and German-speaking, and each has its own elected parliament. The regions and the communities are not quite the same. The German-speaking community, for example, is part of Wallonia, and of course, within this, there is also these communities with, or municipalities with language facilities. Underneath all that, there are 10 provinces, okay, each with their own elected assemblies, five each for Flanders and Wallonia. So the opportunities for corruption certainly abound by this, and there's a lot of inefficiency as a result of this when it comes to multiple governmental layers. Brussels, in a way, is the heart of it. Belgium has three official languages. Only Brussels is officially bilingual. Now, this is despite the fact that between 80 and 90% of the people in Brussels officially list French as their first language. But it's the capital of the Flemish community, and it's historically Dutch-speaking, if you go all the way back before the 19th century, and it's within the borders of Flanders. So, Brussels, being the capital of Flanders, is not open for negotiations when it comes to relaxing this bilingual status. The Flemish insists on less French and more Dutch. The Francophones dig in their heels on their right to speak French in Brussels. In a way, it's majoritarianism versus territorialism. So what's the deal? What's the problem here? French versus Dutch, what's the problem? Well, in a way, linguistic disputes are proxies for underlying problems and wounds. What has made the issue of language so volatile in certain parts of Belgium, Brussels in particular, is one of implicit language hierarchy. the notion that French is still somehow more civilized than Dutch, that it is the regular language. This bothers the Flemish not because they cannot speak French, but because many Walloons refuse to learn Dutch. In the absence of true bilingualism, the Flemish feel put upon to be the ones who always have to speak the other's language as if it were the regular language of the country. Once upon a time it was, and Flemish scratchiness over what language to speak reflects a suspicion that 40% of the country still thinks that way. I'll tell you a little story that was told to me at a dinner party I attended in Brussels. A middle-aged woman related an incident when she was young and went with her mother and father to a store in Brussels to purchase a television. Her mother, whose native language was Dutch, was struggling to make herself understood to the saleswoman, who spoke French but only a few words of Dutch. Her father, whose French was quite good, rescued the saleswoman and restarted the conversation in French. At the end of their shopping, the saleswoman turned to her mother and curtly rebuked her for not having the courtesy to speak French like her husband. It has been decades, but she has never forgotten that moment of embarrassment for her mother. As she said to me, "The wound is still too fresh." She deliberately starts in Dutch in Brussels when she knows the shopkeeper is French-speaking in order to assert a certain bilingual territorialism. Make them struggle with their Dutch until it gets really awkward for them, and then you get to switch to French and prove that you're bilingual and they really are not. So if you do not want to concede that French is the regular language, but you are still trying to get along and get things done in Brussels, what do you do? Simple. The compromise that has worked for the past 40 years or more is to speak more English. You often rely on English as the regular language. It is commonly spoken. It does not implicitly denigrate another language. It does not give a mother tongue advantage to either party. It is neutral. As one wag put it, a little less French for a little more Dutch means a lot more English. As a German-Belgian colleague pointed out to me all the way back in 1988, the way most people avoid offense is by starting off in English when they go into a shop. And more recently, Mika van der Brocke observed something similar in Brussels, where shop assistants regularly start off in English. English is very common in Brussels. It is also global. It's hip, it's young, it's urban. It complements the consumer in advertising by praising them for being part of the in crowd, in being able to understand what a simple English sentence says. And I saw this in Brussels. I was in the airport for 20 minutes before I could possibly spot an advertisement that was not in English. And it was in the men's room, by the way. Brussels is a very international city, with the capital of NATO, as well as EU headquarters and other international organizations, most of which conduct business in English on a formal or informal basis. In fact, the Flemish Minister of Education, Pascal Smet, actually proposed in 2013 that English should be an official language in Brussels. English instruction is available at both the Dutch and French universities in Brussels. Of course, they split the university into French version and a Dutch version. More classes are available in English at the Dutch university than in French, however. And if you major in, if you have a business major, then you take your classes all in English. There's no point in taking Dutch classes for business. It's sort of the unofficial language of the EU. This, despite the official multilingualism of the EU, and despite the official translation policy of the European Parliament. One of the things I discovered is, while officially you're supposed to give your speeches in front of the European Parliament in your native language, because of course they have a whole bank of professional translators, the amount of time that you get is based on a very complicated formula. And if you want to be heard, the smaller parties give their speeches in English, rather than the original language. There's not only the EU and NATO, there are various foreign-born people there. The Belgians enjoy this status as being both the de facto capital of Europe as well as a sort of microcosm of Europe, a representation of an emerging European identity. Will English continue to be the unofficial third language of Brussels? Well, I was speaking with a a Eurocrat, let's call her, who was saying, well, some of the Francophone people in the EU were thinking, you know, with Brexit, the French might come back. The overall trend is clear. One of the people that we talked to was head of the Erasmus program. Erasmus Plus has a goal of essentially promoting a kind of pan-Europeanism. If you attend a university in Europe, you can essentially, you know, become a visiting student at just about any other European university. Well, how is this possible? Because language instruction tends to be in English. As Ruard Vallas de Reis, the policy officer of the EU Directorate General for Education and Culture, said, English is the Latin of the 21st century. What made it possible for someone like Erasmus to travel around and study at various universities is he spoke a common lingua franca, and that was Latin. English has that status now. Not everybody agrees with this, however. The very globalist nature of English in a place like Brussels is simply more evidence for people who live in rural Belgium that Brussels is a scary place that they don't like. This reaction and fear of the cosmopolitan nature of the capital is relatively old. Even before World War I, Jules Destrée, the guy who declared that there are no Belgians, was warning about the Brussels half-breed that, quote, seems to have kept the defects of the two races while losing their qualities. The Belgians of the small towns, Flemings or Walloons, might not be so comfortable in English and thus resent being declared, in essence, not part of the in crowd. Nor is this something unique to Belgium. Go to lots of small towns right here in California and you will find people frightened of going to a place like San Francisco, where all sorts of different people look strange, speak foreign languages, and use garlic in their food. They might even be homosexuals. That fear is not quite nationalism, but it can use the language of nationalism. One of the common complaints in European politics these days is immigrants. Politicians that are currently being labeled populists attack those immigrants, regardless of whether they're economic migrants or political refugees, often under the reasoning that they do not fit in with their society. What they probably mean is that they do not look quite like the people they used to see back when they were much younger. In other words, this part of current nationalism is nostalgia. The funny thing about the good old days is they aren't what they used to be and probably never were. Belgium and other countries have been importing workers from elsewhere, Turkey, Morocco, and other countries for a good 60 years. So the only memories that predate those that are memories of the Second World War. That's hardly the stuff of nostalgia. This new nationalism, particularly in Western Europe, is more of a reaction. It's a sort of globalization hangover. Globalization means many things, but it includes almost unlimited movement of goods, services, communications, and people. And it's the latter two that I'm mostly concerned with here. The globalization of people is what frightens many people in many countries. The people of Boston, England, who voted so overwhelmingly for Brexit, perceive in the Polish grocery stores that have replaced fish and chip shops a sort of unmooring of stable assumptions about who England once was. In the case of Belgium, the globalization of communications has increased the importance of the polyglot capital city, while also increasing the gap between its people and those of the countryside and small towns who do not have such a command of different languages. Being part of the in-crowd means some people get left out, and they often express their resentment at the elitism of those who are part of the in crowd. And it feels better if you can turn the tables and claim membership in a truer, pure, older imagined community, namely the nation. Does that mean Belgium, the state, will break into two different nations with their own states? Despite the rhetoric of some Flemish political parties, this seems unlikely. There are all sorts of obstacles. Belgium is often portrayed as an unhappy marriage that keeps on going for the sake of the children. I guess that makes Brussels the children. Both Flemish nationalist parties support the idea of an independent Flanders to a greater or lesser degree, and this is the Nieuwe Vlaamse Alliantie and the Vlaams Belang. The NVA is part of the government, the VB is not, and there's sort of a cordon sanitaire around the Vlaams Belang because they're much more anti-immigrant. Nobody else believes that Flanders is going to become a truly independent country. I guess the Vlaams belong in the NVA. For one, how would it work? What are we going to do about Brussels? Okay, the Flemish are not going to let that go. That is their capital city, so there's no compromise there. What do we do with municipalities with language facilities, with a significant minority that speak the other language? Do you think the EU is interested in Flemish independence? I don't think so. This would set a very bad precedent. And finally, what about the Belgian national debt? How do we split that up? There are way too many problems for this actually to happen. So where does that leave us in 2017? It seems to me that there's reasons for hope in Belgium, but also reasons to worry. One of the reasons for hope is that the Belgians have a really good sense of humor. They don't take Belgium too seriously. You know, the old saying is that they have a king, a soccer team, and beer, and that's what good beer unites us. There was an elaborate hoax in 2016 by the same television station that punked Yves Le Terme that actually had a huge broadcast. It was kind of like War of the Worlds. Flanders has declared independence. And this went on and on and on. For a good half hour, they had an emergency number to call up on the screen. And when you called it up, they said, ha, 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 it's all just a joke. You started his article off about this. They almost take a perverse pride in having the longest period of time without an official government. Now, the government, in fact, was the same old government and got a lot done during the time. Nonetheless, there is a certain sense of hope for many. A lot of people in Europe put great stock in living in a post-nationalist world. And given the nationalistic strife and bloodshed of the 20th century, you can blame them. Divorce is unlikely, but further separation is possible. Nonetheless, Walloon nationalism is not very strong, and while Flemish nationalism exerts itself at a linguistic level, it does not do much else. When it comes to cooperation with other right-wing nationalist parties, Belgians have not been particularly successful. As far back as the early 1990s, the Vlaams Blok, which was the predecessor of the Vlaams Belang, found it impossible to cooperate with the French National Front in the technical group of the European Right, which was one of the first parliamentary groups in the European Parliament. The Walloon right-wing parties are particularly disorganized and are constantly changing names and identities. The hyper-nationalists, whether Flemish or Walloon, are a minority within Belgium, and an aging one at that. Belgians are also good at compromise, as they've demonstrated in the past. And when you get right down to it, these are not the most serious conflicts in the world. These are first world problems, let's face it. Where we might be pessimistic is in the potential for unity between the communities. By focusing on immigrant communities as foreign, they could find themselves uniting behind Belgium's lowest common denominator. And frankly, in that sense, Belgium might indeed become a trend in Europe. Still, I like to be an optimist. Maybe Belgium is an unhappy marriage, but even unhappy marriages can improve. It takes a lot of work and compromise, and accepting differences is often hard to do. But Belgium has long taken pride in being at the center of something new in Europe, of being at the heart of a new emerging European state. In this era of Brexit and a surging Marine Le Pen, when the idea of Europe is under such a threat, it might be time for plucky little Belgium, Europe's most European country, to pick up the cudgel once again and defend not just its own component parts and identity, but the larger body politic to which it belongs. And in this, plucky little Belgium might be able to lead the way for all of Europe. Sometime in the future, the Duchess of Brabant, Elizabeth, will probably be crowned queen. She will be the first queen regnant in Belgium's history. This will create a problem, though. The Belgians will have to rewrite the lyrics to their national anthem. It'll be easy for the French version, but the Dutch and German versions will have an extra syllable, and so they'll have work to do. Maybe this is a metaphor for the future of the country. Rewriting the lyrics will take work, just like repairing the marriage will take some work. But it can be done, and when it is done, I hope the results will be harmonious, assuming they still have a Belgian when she reaches that point. Thank you all very much.